Welcome to you all on this for Easter Sunday, our celebration. We acknowledge that we're on the lands of the Coast Salish peoples and of their stewardship of this land, and even more so in the sacredness of this earth in this time. We give thanks for that. A few things as we begin. In order for you to celebrate and be a part of this Easter service with us, we invite you to do a couple of things. One is to have a candle around that you might be able to light. And the second is that you would have a piece of bread and also something like wine. For this occasion, I've chosen an Okanagan wine, a Meritage of a 2016 vintage. But it doesn't really matter what the vintage you choose. You might have something else similar. Margaret, what have you chosen?
Well, Mark, you know it's much too early for me to indulge in the wine, so what I've chosen for today is a 2020 vintage bottle of Welch's grape juice.
Okay, so get your wine and your bread or your juice or whatever you have on hand, and let's pour the elements and be ready together. And so we'll invite you to pause as we prepare ourselves for what will be this day.
Welcome back. Let's begin by lighting a candle. While it was still dark, Mary went to the tomb. Tears and sadness and grief were still very much with her. But as she approached, something inside her sparked. Perhaps it was the memories of all the times she had sat with Jesus and the feeling of being empowered by his ministry. This light, friends, has always been so much more than just a light. It has burned within us as we each have come to this moment in time, Easter 2020. And so as we gather in the light of the risen Christ, we welcome you to this service of celebration. Our scripture for this morning is taken from the book of John, reading from chapter 20, verses 1 to 23. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood outside the tomb weeping. And as she wept over and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around, and she saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping, and whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabuni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me because I have not yet ascended to the Father, But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to her. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jewish authorities, Jesus came and stood among them and said, Peace be with you. After this, he had showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. This is the gospel on Easter morn. Thanks be to God.
The Easter story has so many things in it, and each of the gospel writers does it in a different way. I chose John for a couple of reasons this season. And part of it is because it reminds us of the fragility of our emotions. John, more than any of them, uses the emotions of this period of time to kind of heighten the experience of the resurrection. It can be hard, in the midst of all that's happening, for us to even imagine what resurrection will look like. But let's just think about that for a moment. The same was true for Mary Magdalene and the disciples. They weren't expecting a resurrection. They didn't go with any other expectation that other than that death was the reality. And for many in our world right now, death is simply the reality. And we need the time to simply be in the midst of that. But at the same time, the gospel story is an invitation to look around and see where God is showing up when God is least expected. That's the resurrection story. Peter, Mary, none of them expected at all that this was what was going to happen. They went to the tomb with a sense of dread, with the sense that they were putting to rest their friend. And like our context today, they were doing so in secret and in small groups because it wasn't possible for everyone to gather. There wasn't going to be the typical ritual to bury Jesus that would have been typical of a community gathering. They come to this tomb, and they discover that he's not there. Peter and the other disciple, says Gospels John, leave. And Mary's left alone with her grief and her wondering and feeling like she doesn't now know what to do. She's brought her spices. She's brought the things that she knows to do in the midst of grief. And yet, there are none of these things to do. And so when the gardener, in her experience, shows up, she looks to him to try to solve this dilemma. Where have you put him? They have taken my Lord, and I do not know where they have put him. We hear the same lament. They've taken my life, and I don't know where it's gone. They've taken the resources of my family, and I don't know where they've gone. They've taken my routines, and I don't know where they've gone. There's a sense of feeling completely lost in the midst of this new reality. Jesus speaks gently. And slowly it dawns on her that the one that she is missing so deeply is right there. Right there beside her. And her first temptation is to cling on to what she knew and what she knows. And Jesus says, do not cling to me. Do not hold to me, for I have not yet returned the place that I've come from. How badly we want to hold on to those things that we're having to let go of. And we don't know when this ends what those things will be. There will be some things that we can return to normal. There will be some things that are heightened for us now in the value they have that we took for granted before. There will be some new things now that we've learned to embrace. But that is resurrection. The possibility of out of death coming new life. Out of something that is lost, that something new is found. Mary's emboldened by the experience. And while Jesus says to her, "Don't cling to me," and we interpret that in a very physical way, in the same way we're being told we can't cling to others in a physical way now, perhaps the metaphorical piece is, what is it that we need to learn to let go of in order to make room for new life, a new experience? The story as it unfolds, both in the room where Jesus appears to the disciples, and then over and over again in the post-resurrection appearances, God shows up in these unexpected ways. Jesus invites the community to begin to understand that his teachings, his message, his way of being isn't connected as integrally to the physicality of his body, much to the spirit of who he is. And so these disciples who betray Jesus or deny Jesus or all those things now suddenly are emboldened and are able to speak with such enthusiasm and authority that others are drawn to them. The good news of the Easter story is that God shows up again and again. Despite the crushing darkness, despite the death, despite the destruction, despite all that happens, that new life pushes through. And we see that in the spring around us, in the flowers that push up again out of the darkness of the ground, of life that returns as winter skies recede and the sun comes out. The sun will shine. We will be able to meet face to face with our neighbors. We will be able to touch one another again in the weeks ahead. But for now, we hold on to the promise of what that possibility is. That in the brokenness, that new life comes. That in the death of what was, that something else emerges. That God shows up, and we too are there waiting and ready to be and make that journey with God. So, we move now to our communion as a way of symbolizing these very words. I'm going to invite Margaret back, and keeping the appropriate social distancing, as you also are doing, we want to invite you into this time of sharing communion. Typically, communion is something we share in and amongst us, and so to do so virtually is a very different kind of experience for all of us. If this is the first time you've ever participated in communion here at Cadbro Bay, we want you to know a couple of things. That no matter who you are, or where you come from, or what your creed is, or any of the other typical barriers sometimes that are seen in the midst of a celebration of the sacrament, that those do not exist. Not just because we're in the midst of COVID, but because that is the very nature of the holy and of God. And so whether you are tall or short or somewhere in between, whether you are gay or straight or somewhere in between, whether you are single or married or somewhere in between, whether you're young or old or somewhere in between, no matter where on any of those spectrums, male, female, somewhere in between, you are a child of God. and are welcome at this table. And so together, with all the folks that we can imagine, past and present, we now participate in this communion feast. Bread is needed out of yeast and flour and water, and with time and warmth, it expands and is baked. But the touch of human hands is needed for bread to come into being. And so symbolic in this Easter time is bread that comes alive again and expands in its fullness. In this Easter time, we also have wine. Wine that comes into its fullness with time and fermentation and patience, that's crushed from the grapes that spring from the vine and from the ground, and remind us with its sweetness that God is indeed good. And so these elements are symbolic of Easter. And every time we celebrate this, we're reminded that these simple elements of bread and wine, or whatever it is that you have, are symbols of the common everyday that are made sacred by our intentionality and our presence together.
And so on that last night, they gathered once again, as they had so many times, sharing a meal, sharing some laughs, entering into deep conversation as they talked so many times before about the ministry that they were empowered with. But this time felt a little different, perhaps. But on that day, Jesus took a piece of bread and he blessed it and he broke it, giving thanks to God. And he said, "This bread is for you. Take it, taste it, eat it, and every time you do this, I am with you."
In the same way as the meal came to the end, Jesus gave thanks for the cup, and he passed it to his friends and said, "Take and drink, and each time you do this, remember me." And so together, with each of us and our elements, we take these things: the bread of life, the cup of promise, and we hear the words of our passage, "Peace be with you."
Peace be with you.
Let us share together in our meal. Bread of life. And while our tradition typically in the United Church is to not share from a common cup, it's the advantage of the changes of COVID that we all have our own. The cup of the promise. A good year, if I do say so myself, thank you.
Not bad.
And so, may you be refreshed and filled, knowing that you participate in this with one another. May this bread of life and may this cup of promise be yours today, tomorrow, and always.
Thanks be to God for this meal we have shared together. Bread and wine, joy and hope, forever and ever. Amen.
Let's prepare ourselves for prayer.
Dear friends, it has been said that wherever two or three are gathered, the Spirit of God is right in our midst. And surely that has never felt more true. And I'm especially thinking of you as you gather, perhaps one at your supper table tonight, or maybe you're with a small group, but wherever you are, The Spirit of God is indeed joining us one to the other. Let us join together now in prayer. And so, O God, we confess that this Easter feels like one for the record books. There has been isolation and fear, anxiety and feelings of sadness and confusion. And yet, O sacred source, if we have witnessed anything this last month, perhaps we are closer than ever to re-entering the mysterious, terrifying, unexplainable moments of that first rising. You are indeed the Spirit of light amidst the darkness, and unrestrained joy and gratitude amidst the chaos and sadness. You are the color amidst the charcoal shards of death, and you are the symbol of hope rising amidst all that would keep us entombed. On this Easter weekend, we marvel again and again at the Spirit of life that can never be held down, and the Spirit of compassion that cannot be stopped as we band together in unity and love. Like pots and pans and bells that proclaim our gratitude each evening, even the stones will not keep silence, for the message of Easter has always been in the power of the community of Jesus, in noticing and appreciating, in keeping the vulnerable safe, and in finding a way forward together. This way is your way, O God, and it speaks of hope, especially wherever it is most needed. In this time, hear now our prayers for this world of which we are but one small part. For all who are struggling, especially those in the midst of COVID and other illnesses, those who are feeling deeply this time of isolation and grief. We lift up Ellen Mahoney's brother, Dave Macri, who continues to fight COVID-19, that he may have a steady recovery. For Keith and Kathy Wolford, and for Krista Holbin, and for all others, O God, who we name in our hearts. We remember those who we would long to be with at table this evening, and we recognize that there is still sadness at not being able to physically join together. We raise up those on the edges and the margins, those who cannot feel safe if they have no home to retreat to, and those where home rarely feels safe to begin with. We remember those on stretched incomes. We remember single parent families who are starting to come unglued. We remember those who have lost jobs and been laid off, and those who are waiting for financial assistance to kick in. O Easter God, we have seen you rise in such incredible acts of sacrifice and perseverance through the frontline healthcare workers, through all who are working in essential services, in the diligence of our health officers, and in all levels of government and civil service. And your rising has been no less spectacular in the many acts of kindness and compassion between neighbors, between strangers, between and amongst your beautiful world community. In so many ways, the message and hope of the risen Christ has never been more crystal clear. Whatever you do to the least of these, you do to and for me. And so it is in the beauty of this day, in the love that bursts within our hearts and cannot be contained, in the quiet peace that we feel at the close of a day, we rise with you and with each other in and through your love that simply will never die. Alleluia and amen. We've come to a moment now where we're going to have a time of song. And so we've included in the email words to the well-known and beloved Easter hymn, Lord of the Dance. And so we invite you to either sing along with us or to just reflect and lift up the gratitude in your heart this day.
Dance, dance, wherever you may be. And Jesus appeared to the disciples, and he said to them, "Peace be with you." And then he looked at them and said, "May the Holy Spirit reside with you all." May that be true for all of you this weekend and onward. May the peace of Christ be with you, and may the Spirit dwell within you, your family, your neighbors, and indeed our world. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, and happy Easter.